Hello, this is Baradwaj Rangan. You're watching Film Companion's weekly show, Ask BR. And today we're going to talk about Velaikkaran. You've sent in a lot of questions. Let's look at the first one. Siddharth wants to know, actually, this is a question about last week's movie, Aruvi. He's asking, as a fan of good cinema, doesn't the plagiarism stigma affect the ways in which Aruvi would be seen in subsequent years? I, for a matter of fact, don't have the same awe towards movies like Nandalala, another critically acclaimed movie, but plagiarized. See, this is a thing that one often wrestles with, right? Because ideally, you don't want to know about this, but the thing is also, two things are here. One is it really plagiarized? I haven't seen the original, which is supposed to be, you know, the movie supposed to be based on. I haven't seen that, so I cannot make a comment on that yet. But my take on this is this. So, even if there is a certain core that's similar, it still takes a certain amount of skill and craft to make a movie, right? I mean, it's not just, you cannot just copy the same thing frame to frame and make a movie. That's a problem. I don't think in that way Aruvi is a plagiarized film at all, at least doesn't seem to be. So I will reserve my comments until I see it. But as of now, there is so much skill in the writing and in the making of the movie, and especially in the acting. And, you know, and acting also has to do with a lot of how the director directs the performance, right? So I would be a little, I don't know if I'll make a summary judgment like that. So let's look at the questions about Velaikkaran. Navneet Narayan says, I saw the movie, it was good, but there's one question. Sivakarthikeyan starts out as an RJ to enlighten his slum youth and to free them from Prakash Raj's gang. But once he gets a job, the story moves totally in a different direction. Do you think the director tackled both issues equally? I don't think it moves in a different direction. It's actually kind of related. So initially, Sivakarthikeyan is in his world of the slum, right? He wants to make these people aspire for a better life. And in doing so, he himself aspires for a better life, and he moves outside and, you know, begins to make a better life for himself. So it's all kind of interrelated. So we start with the local and then we move to the global. So I think even in terms of the movie's message, we start with a local message about the boys in the slum, and then we move to a global message about, you know, what the movie says about, you know, the foodstuffs and things like that. So I think it's a gradual progression, but the movie is not a very evenly made movie. So maybe it does seem a little lumpy, but I don't see these two as being two different issues as such. Nikhil Chaudhary asks, do you think Velaikkaran parallels Shankar's style of a common man rising against the system? What do you think changed about Mohan Raja's earlier commercials and his work in Taniyoran and Velaikkaran? What do I think changed? I think he's just become so much better as a writer. Certainly it just seems to have, his ambition seems to have become totally different. Because he's taking these mainstream formats and then putting in stuff that's like very, very interesting, which is really difficult. In a way, it's easier to make an art movie that's truer to a vision. Do you think about the Shankar style of a common man rising against the system? I think there's a difference because I think almost all masala movies have the same thing of, a man rising against something. So I think this is more of that. A Shankar style is a little bit of a unique kind of masala where it's a little larger than life than even the masala movie. I mean, the masala movie itself is larger than life. A Shankar's movie is even more larger than life. And I think it also has to do with the Shankar's films also have to do with one specific wrongdoing that instigates a systemic cycle of revenge by the protagonist. That is not there in this because it is not one particular wrongdoing, but more a generic problem that these people are addressing. So I think there's a bit of a difference between Shankar's style and this one. So Lijo John asks, do you think Sivakarthikeyan has reached a stardom level where he can carry a heavy subject-oriented film with a big message and deliver it to the masses successfully? And, yes, I think he has, because, see, when you're talking about a subject-oriented film or whatever message, what you're really talking about is whether the hero is convincing, right? And I think he's totally convincing in what he does. Yes, he has got a lighter persona than the other people, but in a strange way, I find it easier to listen to Sivakarthikeyan, in this mode than a heavier hero, because it doesn't seem that much of a message. It kind of seems like he's, because he has his boy next door vibe, it seems like, you know, he is suffering these things and therefore he's kind of, you know, learning as he goes along. See, that's one thing in Velaikkaran. You get the impression that he's learning as he goes along, that he's making mistakes and he's learning. Whereas with the bigger hero, you know, they're always right, and you know, they always come know what the right thing is, what the right thing to say at every right moment. This way he's, you know, I get this impression that this is a little more relatable than that kind of message movie. Do you see Tamil actors, same person asked, do you see Tamil actors keeping their stardoms away and taking movie to do an interesting role with Shades of Grey? I don't think so, because Shades of Grey is a little unusual. Ajit did it in Mangata. I don't know if most actors would do that regularly, because it kind of alienates certain core constituencies and it may be a little difficult. And finally he asks, why is it so important for mass entertainment in cinema entertainment cinema in Tamil to have a message always? I don't know. I think it kind of ties in with something another commenter left in the YouTube space. It says, this is a huge problem with Tamil cinema today. They don't want to make good films. They just want to make a star hero look good. So I think I really found this a very interesting comment, because, you know, it's not just about making a good film. By delivering this message, you know, the hero or the star ends up looking good. So I think that may be a reason for the message heaviness of these movies. Nandakumar Tirupati asks, the film deals with delivering a vast amount of information in an engaging manner without diluting the content. I felt this was necessary. The film had to be made this way. What do you think? So this is another viewpoint of this whole message thing. This person thinks, you know, it's not only delivering all these information and facts in an engaging manner, he feels it necessary. So that's another reason movies are message heavy, because there is lots of people, you might have heard this thing about, you know, nalla padam ena nalla karuthu. Because so a lot of people, you know, think that a good film is one that comes with a good message. So that may be another reason that, you know, Tamil cinema keeps, you know, ending up having a message always. About the message thing again, Ajay Mohan says, why use such lengthy repetitive dialogues in the second half to convey the message rather than smart and crisp writing? Then when you mentioned Sivakarthikeyan fits the role like a glove, I felt he couldn't carry the whole film entirely on his shoulders except the RJ part. What is your take on this? I've already talked about Sivakarthikeyan and the message movie, so I'm not going to repeat that. But lengthy repetitive dialogues in the second half, I agree, because after a point, it did seem like they were giving variations of the same thought. It was like, you know, you kept hearing the same things over and over again. So that was a problem. I don't think they thought that through completely, because, you know, rather than building one kind of realization on the earlier one and kind of gradually, cumulatively kind of getting to a larger idea, I think they kind of got the whole thing once and then they kept repeating that entire block again and again and again, and that was a problem. Ajay Mohan also asks, do you think Sivakarthikeyan would ever do a role with Shades of Grey? Again, a little bit of the earlier question, can a Tamil film star ever do a role where he's a total douchebag? For example, do you see any Tamil film star who has a mass following ever doing a role like what Fahad did in Tondi Mudalam Drikshakshiyam or Dulkar did in Kamati Padam? Frankly, no, I don't think so, because the audiences are totally different, and the way the star is perceived is also totally different. See, in Tamil and Telugu cinema, a star is a very mass-like cult figure. So you cannot play with these things, you know. Whereas in Malayalam cinema, the star stardom does not preclude him from playing a variety of roles. In fact, the stardom sometimes comes as a result of this. Whereas in Tamil and Telugu cinema, the stardom comes as the result of playing a particular kind of role. That's the role that the people accept the star in. So to kind of deviate from that usually takes a lot, you know, if they're still interested in maintaining the stardom, which is kind of what Sivakarthikeyan told in his interview to me in Film Companion as well. Mahima Nandakumar asked, personally, I really liked Velaikkaran, but if you could tell me what could have been better in the script, what would that be? What could have been better in the script is the whole second half, because once, you know, we get to know who the villain is and who the, you know, what the arc is going to be, the film seems to stop and it just comes to kind of, you know, keeps going around in circles. So instead of building towards one thing that would really explode, and I think that would be different. The other thing that I would change is also the way Nayanthara is used in the film. There are some questions about that, you know, because she's kind of has an interesting beginning, but then later she tapers off, almost like she goes off into doing nothing. And maybe she could have been part of the way in which the hero is kind of, you know, finds himself. Because I really, really like the scene in which the hero's mother is used to kind of, you know, make him see a certain way of doing things. I think that's a brilliant scene. And I think, you know, some more scenes like that would have really helped. A number of people, Tommy Wilson, Twinkle Verma, ask, how's Fahad in the movie? I'm sorry, but I've seen Fahad Fasil in much, much, much better movies and roles, so I didn't feel it was much of a stretch for him to do here at all. Padmanabhan asks another variation on the Fahad question. Do you think it's a better movie to launch a potential actor like Fahad Fasil? See, I think this works in two ways. Is it a better movie? Is this the best movie to launch Fahad Fasil in Tamil? Maybe not, because, you know, in terms of actor-wise, right? Because it's not the greatest of roles, and it's like he doesn't really have to do too much in terms of stretching. But you think of the star value, right? Because it's a huge star film. It gets a lot of visibility. So the number of people who will see Fahad Fasil in this in Tamil Nadu is an enormous number. So I think that considered, it's not a bad role at all. It's just a little bit of a commonplace role. So that considered, yes, I do think this might be a good way to kind of test the waters in Tamil cinema for Fahad Fasil. Mohit Maheshwari asks, how is Velaikkaran being seen as a game changer for Sivakarthikeyan? Is it because it is the actor's widest release in Tamil Nadu? What is the maximum screen capacity? I don't know things like screen capacity and all, because that's the business side of things. But why is it being seen as a game changer? Because now, you know, this is the first time he stepped out of his comfort zone and is doing a kind of movie. I mean, he did a bit of it in Kaki Sate, where he played an action hero, but there was still a lot of the comedy and stuff there. Whereas here, he's taking on a typical mass role, and, you know, he's kind of doing this whole, you know, I'm taking on a serious issue and I'm doing a message kind of thing for the first time. So I think that in that way, it's a bit of a game changer. So if the movie does well, then he's, you know, it's going to shift his stardom to a different kind of different orientation. Pratap asks, why the second half didn't work for you? Again, the same, I just answered that. And Arvind Shiram actually gives a good explanation for this. He said the second half felt like an audiobook. The intelligence from Thani Oruvan had evaporated. That's it, an audiobook, because we kept hearing so much of the same dialogue. And, you know, the film could have used a little more cinema, you know, a little bit of a cinematic treatment of the whole thing. Venkat Ramachandran says, is the company named used? Does it have a meaning outside the cinema too? So the name of the company is Saffron Industries or something like that. So, you know, when Sivakarthikeyan brings down Saffron Industries, you know, I actually laugh, because, you know, you're talking about the one state that the Saffron Party has not been able to come into is this state, you know, the one big state. And, you know, and is this, I don't think this is actually a reference to that. But yes, it's, you know, movies have, you know, bring up these meanings sometimes that are unintended. And this is certainly an amusing way to kind of look at that whole, you know, a Tamilian bringing, you know, resisting the lure of the Saffron kind of thing. That's really interesting. Rohit Aradhya asks, why do you think the Kuppam scenes were given a yellow tint and the corporate scenes a bluish shade? This is a classic cinematographic technique, because yellow is warm, blue is cold, right? So when you have yellow Kuppam scenes, that's like you're talking about a community, you're talking about people who are together, people are bonding together, people who need to be set right. They're all like, you know, they all know each other, they're all neighbors. So this warmth of the community is given warm tones, whereas a corporate world is cold, it's distant, you know, people are using each other only for selfish motives, they're using each other. So I think, you know, the clear demarcation between the two worlds, the you know, you would have seen this in a lot of films, and this is what is done in this film as well. Anirudh Ane asks, what do you think of the cast management in the movie? Because the movie had a number of big stars. When you talk about cast management, I think, you know, it did have a big stars, but I think Nayanthara was kind of wasted, you know, and I think Fahad Fasil also got a bit of an easy role, but at least he had a bigger role, you know, so I don't, you know, it would have been nicer if everyone had gotten a role befitting their stardom, but I think, you know, this ultimately became a Sivakarthikeyan movie, so the other stars kind of got a bit of short shrift. Hariharan actually asked a version of the same question, and that's the answer. Dada Matthew asks, wonder why a talented actress like Nayanthara wants to act in this movie, such a waste. See, sometimes it's just nice to, just do a light role. You know, one doesn't always need to be doing heavy roles all the time. You know, especially, you know, this question often comes up, it's not a role worthy of someone or something like that. I don't think so at all, because if someone just wants to go and have some fun, you know, in a big commercial star film, they should not be denied that opportunity. We should just be like, I mean, as long as they're doing the other kind of stuff, I think once in a while this kind of departure is actually kind of nice. Ramji says, there were a lot of portions which were well written rather than directed. Mohan Raja has really evolved as a writer. What is your thought about that? Yes, I really felt the writing was much better than the direction in this film. And yes, he has evolved as a writer, because, you know, there's a way the Kuppam scenes effectively about how the radio figures into all that is brilliantly done, because it's kind of the radio is the radio station is used, the RJ thing is used, especially in that fight scene. It's used so brilliantly that, you know, that's real writing. It's not just some, you know, something that's done to prop up a star or something like that. It integrates that whole world of the movie so beautifully. So I think, you know, to get that kind of a stretch from Mohan Raja is very, I mean, you wouldn't have expected that before Tani Oruvan, right? So that he's really evolved as a writer. Finally, Piyush Das Patnaik asks, what would be the most apt summary of Velaikkaran? I would say it's a movie that tries to do some interesting things. It's a movie that, culturally speaking, is a little significant, because it takes a star and kind of tries to, you know, expand his reach a bit. And I think it takes, it's also a movie about a filmmaker who's kind of evolving and is trying to find a voice within the masala framework to say new things. So I think it's an interesting film overall. And so that's it for Velaikkaran this week. See you again next week in next week's edition of Ask BR. Thank you so much for your questions. Keep watching Film Companion.
Hi, this is Baradwaj Rangan. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you'd like to see more, do subscribe to Film Companion South.